Now we turn to what will be the motion of a particle in a magnetic field. We have seen what the force looks like, right? Now let us assume we have a magnetic field which is directed as shown. Okay, so it is directed into the plane of the paper. Okay, it is directed into the plane of the paper, and let us say I have a positively charged particle, right? A positively charged particle here. Okay, this is positive Q, which is say shot like that. Okay, which is shot like that. Fine. Now what happens? How will it move if after firing it we just leave it? What trajectory will it take in this magnetic field is what we are trying to see, right? Now what happens if this is V and I have my B that is into the plane of the paper? So it is something like that. Okay, it is V that is like that, and there is a B which is into the plane of the paper. So what happens? V cross B points to the left, right? Currently it points to the left, so it is something like that, correct? So that is the direction of the force. It gets multiplied by Q, but Q is positive, so the direction of V cross B remains the direction of F. The scalar multiplication by a positive keeps at least the direction the same. Okay, and currently I'm not much bothered about the magnitude. Okay, so this is the direction in which it experiences the force, correct? Now whenever you have a force and hence an acceleration perpendicular to your direction of motion, it will try to pull it into a circular motion. Do we get that? It will convert it into a circular motion. It is the circular motion where the acceleration is always perpendicular to the direction of motion. Is it not? And since it is exactly that, we'll see that this particle, say with a particular radius, will move in a trajectory that is circular. That is circular. Okay. This kind of. Yes, doubts. Okay. And at every point, even when it comes here and say the velocity is directed tangential, obviously, you see, what is V cross B? V cross B will be again perpendicular and will again be pointing always perpendicular to the direction. So if it starts with a circular thing to start with, okay, the circular nature that carries through always, because wherever it goes, see if it goes like that, this is V, okay, try to do that V cross B, okay, so
it's always been this direction.
Yeah, so B is something like that, okay, mm-hmm. Perpendicular to that and perpendicular to these two is again this. So force is always in a direction that is perpendicular to it, correct? and in fact it is that force which is providing it the centripetal acceleration. Okay, the center seeking acceleration is being provided by that very force, right? And what is my centripetal acceleration? What is my force? They are all mutually perpendicular. So as far as the magnitude of the force is concerned, force is indeed QV cross B. So it is QVB sine theta. Okay, as far as the magnitude is concerned. And what is theta? What is the angle between V and B? They are perpendicular to each other. So theta here is 90 degree. And I get force as QVB, correct? And it is this force which is providing you with the centripetal acceleration. And what is my centripetal acceleration? We have seen that our centripetal acceleration is this force QVB is actually equal to MV square upon R, where R is the radius of this circle, right? Where R is the radius of the circle, R, right? This is the radius. Now, can I find the radius in terms of the other parameters? The answer is yes. So what is R equal to? This V cancels this, right? So there is a V here. So it becomes MV upon QB. Okay. It will be MV upon QB. Do we see that? So what we mean to say is that my radius is directly proportional to the momentum. Right? My radius is directly proportional to the momentum. R is equal to MV upon QB. Okay? And this velocity remains a constant. Why? Because you have a force that is always acting in a direction perpendicular to it, so it is not accelerating it in the direction in which it is moving. Okay? So this force constantly keeps on changing the direction of this, but this V remains the same. So it becomes a uniform circular motion, correct?
Right? So the same of the centripetal acceleration is
only. Yes, because the acceleration is towards the center, so it only works to change the direction.
So there is no centrifugal force acting.
Centrifugal force automatically comes into being. Whenever you have an acceleration in one direction, in the opposite direction there will be a centrifugal force, always. Here you call it centrifugal, otherwise it becomes a pseudo force. That's a pseudo force that you'll feel. Okay? So R is equal to MV upon QB. V remains the same. I know this. So what is the time taken? What is the time taken to complete one revolution? Time taken to complete one revolution is called the time period, right? To complete one revolution is called the time period. The time period T. Okay, the time period T. And what is that? That is the distance traveled in completing one full rotation, that is 2 pi r divided by the velocity which remains a constant. So that is 2 pi r is the capital R upon V, right? And what is 2 pi r upon V? From here you see we get the value of R upon V as what? M upon QB, is it not? It is M upon QB. So it just gets multiplied by 2. So it becomes 2 pi m upon QB. So So the time period becomes 2 pi m by qb. Get the point? What is the frequency? What is the number of revolutions per second? The frequency, as you see, is how do I do that? In t seconds, there is one revolution. So in 1 second, there is 1/t revolution, and that is what is the number of revolutions in 1 second is called the frequency of revolution. Right, so the frequency of revolution, nu is equal to 1 upon t, which is equal to qb upon 2 pi m, that is nu, right? So that is what it is. Now there is an interesting thing to see, that this time period is actually independent of the radius. It is independent of the radius. Okay, it only depends on the m and qb. So whatever be the radius, let this be the radius, or let the radius be 1 kilometer, the time that it will take will be the same. And now why does that happen? See, if you want this radius to be the double, come here, then with m and q and b remaining the same, the mass of this particle m and the charge on this and the magnetic field remaining the same, you will have to double the velocity with which you fire it. Okay, you double the velocity, the radius doubles, the distance doubles because it is 2 pi r, and then you divide it by double the velocity, right, of what it was earlier. So if the distance has doubled, that is on account of the doubling of the velocity, and when they two get divided, you get the time as the same. So if once you have you're done with your mass, that you have decided on the mass of the particle and the q of the particle, charge on the particle, and the b of the system, that remains the same, whatever be the velocity with which you fire the charge, the radius remains the same. Do we get that? The radius will not change. I'm extremely sorry. The time period will not change. The time taken to complete one revolution won't change. The radius will keep on changing, but so will the velocity, right? Because the radius will change on account of velocity. Fine. So the time period and the frequency, they are pretty independent of the velocity. And that is something that we'll use in a device called cyclotron, right? This property will come very handy when we use it in a cyclotron to accelerate the particles, to increase the speed of the particles. We get the point? Okay. So in conclusion, we want to say that. In conclusion, we want to say that the motion of a charged particle short perpendicular to the magnetic field is circular. Okay, it is circular. What else? R is equal to mv upon qb, that is, the radius depends on the momentum. Okay, and time period is is 2 pi r by v, that is 2 pi m by qb, and the frequency is qb upon 2 pi m. And we have seen that the time period and the frequency are independent of the velocity, right? So t and nu are independent of the velocity.
But they indirectly depend on the radius.
Since they are independent of the radius.
I'm sorry. They are independent of the radius. Yes. How about velocity? They are also independent of the velocity. That does not appear, right? It simply is not there. It's strange, right? But it's true.